2.5 years, 3 years, we had anticipated how the Supreme Court was going to rule, and we would have been talking about the implications of that. Really, we have been trying to contact different groups. Fred was in charge of doing that, and he contacted some people, some other churches, like in the Metroplex area, like Denton Baptist Church. We talked to some people here in town about how to protect the church in case something happens. And what we never, you know, it's kind of like you're expecting a death in the family. And, but it's still a shock when it happens. We could see where the culture was going. We knew how the court, the Supreme Court, had ruled before. And so it was no surprise to us. But nonetheless, it's still a shock. When I was driving over here yesterday morning, I thought about what our country has been, where our country is today. And the decision that came down Friday by the Supreme Court. And I literally just started crying. Not because I'm just sad for this country, because I've seen it going downhill for a long time. What has saddened me more than the culture is really been the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ. But what was sad about it, to me, and what was so grieving, hopefully, to our hearts, is to see a country that was once founded on Judeo-Christian principles not only defy God, but to codify the sin, a sin, into law, and make it the law of the land. Abraham Lincoln, speaking to the young men's YMCA group of men at the Lyceum of Springfield, Illinois, January 27, 1838, he warned of destructive forces from within the country. At the time, he was talking about, specifically about slavery. But this is what he said. He said, "Shall we expect some transatlantic military giant to step the ocean and crush us at a blow? Never. All the armies of Europe, Asia, and Africa combined, with all the treasure of the earth, our own excepting, in their military chest, with a Bonaparte for a commander, could not by force take a drink from the Ohio or make a track on the Blue Ridge in a trial of 1,000 years. At what point then is the approach of danger to be expected? I answer, if it ever reach us, it must spring up amongst us. It cannot come from abroad. If destruction be our lot, we must ourselves be its author and finisher. As a nation of free men, we must live through all time or die by suicide." I don't know what's going to happen to the United States, but I do know what is going to happen to the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because God never hid that from us. I want you to turn your Bibles to Genesis 1, just to give us a perspective, the biblical, not a perspective, but the biblical perspective of what we're talking about. So, the issue that we face, that we have faced for a long time, is not an issue of opinions. It's not, and by the way, let me say this. We need to quit relying on the polling data, the surveys, to determine whether something is right or wrong, whether something is truth or error. In the abortion debate, one of the things I've heard is there are a little bit higher percentage of people who believe in life. Listen, if only a handful of people believe in life because God says so, then that is so. It doesn't matter if the world says it is right, then if God says it is wrong, it is still wrong. So let me give you what God says about His design for us. One of the things that we see in the scriptures is we know that the marriage is not like just simply two people. I explained this when I do premarital counseling. Marriage is a covenant, not between a husband and a wife, but between the sovereign God and two people who want to agree with God on what He has already said and how He set the parameters for that. And this is what God said. In beginning in verse 26 of chapter 1, then God said, let us make man in our image, in our likeness, and let them rule or have dominion over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So that was God's intent. The intent was for man to image God, to reflect who He is, to reflect the oneness, the love, the perfection that is there in the triune God. So verse 27, so He created man in His own image. In the image of God, He created him. Now, don't miss that point. He created man in whose image? In His image. We do not remake God according to the image of man, but God made man according to His own image. And notice what He says and how He did that. God created man in His own image. In the image of God, He created him male and female. He created them. And God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number, fill the earth and subdue it. And then He talks again about dominion. The purpose for marriage is God wanted man, once men, husband and wife, male and female, coming together in holy matrimony to reflect the very glory, the very love, oneness, and unity that exists in the triune God. And out of that, procreation is very much a part of that. And that's also why I struggle. And I see how the culture has seeped in into the thinking in the hearts of even those in the church. It reminds me of what the psalmist says. They mingled with the nations and adopted their customs. When we find out that someone is having their fifth or sixth or seventh child, I don't even have to go to a pagan to get a negative reaction about that. I find it in the church. Why is it that we do that? Because we have not understood the very purpose for which God created us and for which man, God put man and woman, husband and wife together. And just the very sense of that tells us that there is no deviation from that. God was the one who designed it. It is His purpose to reflect who He is, and it is who we are in terms of agreeing. When we come together in holy matrimony, we agree to the sovereign, to the covenant, to the sovereign God, and to His terms for us of what a husband and a wife really mean in a marriage looks like. Well, Genesis chapter 2. This is, you know the text. Chapter 1 gives us a general picture of what God did in creation. Chapter 2 gives us the specifics of how He created man and woman. Verse 18 says, and the Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him. Now the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the wild animals and all the birds in the sky. He brought them to the man to see what he would name them, and whatever the man called each living creature, that was its name. So the man gave names to all the livestock, the birds in the sky, and all the wild animals. But for Adam, no suitable helper was found. The word suitable means one who completes him. And helper means one who is opposite him, meaning in the sense of, really, it's not proper for me to discuss with you even the physiological and the physical differences that is in all of that, but there's so many complementary ways that a man and a woman can come together in the way we think. You know this, men are not as communicative, it's not as good in communication as women are. That is just how God created the man and the woman. The child, the baby, when it's conceived, and if it's XY chromosome, a certain time during that development of that boy child, when it's now being all babies, I didn't know this, all babies start out as female, and then but there's a certain time when there's a change, and when the change comes, one of the things that happens is it floods the system, the body, including the brain, of these powerful chemicals, and it changes the way we think. Men have, well, we all have two sides of the brain, the left hemisphere, the right hemisphere, connected together by millions of connectors called the corpus callosum. Well, what happens during the time of development of a male child, a lot of that, those connectors are destroyed. And so man can only function generally, not all men, but generally can function from one side of the brain, and it's not the side that controls speech and communication. And that is why it is a struggle in marriage. If we will understand what the Word of God says about us, we will understand what He wants from us. But anyway, he says that. And again, let me just say something here. The word for helper, there's only one other person in the scriptures that is called helper other than the woman, other than the wife, and it's God. A lot of times people will say women are put down because they are considered as helpers. No. God is, you are on the same level. You are functioning in the way that God functions in that sense. It says in verse 20, no, for Adam no suitable helper was found. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep, and while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and then closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man. The man said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man. That is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. It is clear, Genesis 1, Genesis 2, what God said, that marriage is going to be between a man and a woman. There are no deviations from that according to God's design, according to the Creator's design. It is very clear in the scriptures. Homosexuality is not new. It has been around. Genesis 19, Sodom and Gomorrah, the two angels that the Lord sent to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. You remember when they got to Sodom and Gomorrah and Lot met them in Sodom. And the men of the town wanted those two angels to be to come out of Lot's under his roof so that they can do things, abominable things with them. They were doing the same thing in Genesis 19. In Judges 19, it's the same thing. There was a Levite who had a concubine, and they were traveling home. Late one night, they stopped at Gibeah, one of the towns, and a bunch of them occupied by the tribe, people from the tribe of Benjamin. What did they do? Well, the man, an older man, gave them shelter during the night. It's the same thing as Sodom and Gomorrah. They wanted the man to come out so that they can molest him. And instead, they gave the man his concubine, and they did abominable things to her. The Greek and the Roman cultures did the same thing. Greeks did practice it openly. The Romans did when their armies went to war. Part of the awards that they got was they could have not just women but men, boys. So it's been around for a long, long time. But now it is no longer just part of the worldly culture. What we did, what this nation did last week, was we codified it into law, and it became the law of the land. What we have said, basically, that which is against, clearly a sin against God, we said it is now fine, and it's the law of the land. As God says in the book of Romans, it's talking about the sinfulness that we have, and the wrath of God is being revealed to all mankind, because that which is obvious about God, His power, His glory, man has suppressed it and denied it. And so he said, and therefore their minds became useless, their hearts became darkened. And it says they exchanged the truth of God for a lie, and worship and serve created things rather than the Creator. Because of this, God gave them over to shameful lusts. Even their women exchanged natural relations for unnatural ones. In the same way, the men also abandoned natural relations with women and were inflamed with lust for one another. Men committed indecent acts with other men and received in themselves a due penalty for their perversion. Get this, because the last part of this, in verse 32, is what happened last Friday. Although they know God's righteous decree, and this country is not ignorant in the things of God, even though they know God's righteous decree that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these very things, but also approve of those who practice them by codifying it into the law of the land. Basically, the nation has approved it. Well, one of the things we talked about yesterday, the elders and I talked about yesterday, is what are the implications for our church? And I just want to be very honest with you, and that's why instead of going into Isaiah this morning, I wanted to discuss this. Be honest, there's a part of me that grieves. In fact, I grieved Friday and yesterday. I told, I think, my family and the elders yesterday more than I grieved when Kim died. I knew what was happening with Kim. Hebrews 9:27 says, it is destined for man to die once and after that in judgment. I knew God had set the limits as far as how long Kim is going to live. And we trusted, she and I and our family trusted the Lord for that. We knew that. I know from what the Bible says that I will see Kim again. And I can't wait for that day. But what happened Friday was we as a nation basically, and I know it is the judges, and you might even say it is five justices of the U.S. Supreme Court. But the culture has been moving in that direction for a long, long time. That we have said it's okay. We have denied the very Lord, the very thing that God says in Romans 1. The wrath of God is being poured out on all mankind. Because that which is obvious about Him, His glory and His power. Basically, the United States says, we don't want you. We're shaking our fists at you. I appreciate the prayer that Bautista prayed this morning as we gathered here at 8 o'clock for prayer time. And he said, Father, thank you for your grace. And people who are in rebellion against you, spewing their rebellion against you, do not even realize that it's by your grace that they're able to breathe. Yes, that is true. I don't know if you noticed, Sue, and I appreciate Sue, she's always very good about decorating the church. I could not, and I was talking to Andrew about this, I couldn't just celebrate. And so I draped this in black. Because there should be a sense of mourning and grieving about us. It is not for the United States, just business as usual. And that is also the reason next week we had plans doing things to celebrate Independence Day. We will still eat. And we will still get together. But instead of just playing games and doing things, I would like for us to pray. And I would like to challenge us to think about in terms of what God, who God is and what He said. And I don't know yet, but maybe I'll tell you. I mean, we don't even know the struggles that we've had. Reading a book right now about Baptists in America and the struggles that we have. How even the Puritans persecuted and killed a lot of the Baptists. That's why we don't have a lot of written history about Baptists. I knew about that about Europe. I didn't realize that that was also going on here in the United States. The Presbyterians, the Congregationalists, they're the ones who persecuted the Baptists and anyone who would just proclaim basically the reality that you have to be converted, you have to know Christ as your Savior. That was so different from what they knew, because at the time the church was for you to become a member of the church, you were simply baptized as an infant and you become part of the church and you grow up in the church. And the Baptists said, no, you have to know Christ as your Savior, and it can only happen when you become an adult with your own mind and you understand who God is, how you've sinned against Him, and you understand the provision that He has given us through His Son, the finished work of Jesus Christ, and then when you trust Him, then you become a believer, and then you are baptized. It's what we call believer's baptism. I didn't realize it was going on here in the United States also, or in the colonies at the time. But let me just share with you what we talked about, some of the implications for our church. We don't know this, but we know there's probably going to be a lot of lawsuits that's going on. Probably we will be tested in terms of whether we will perform same-sex marriages or even use the facilities for same-sex marriages. And of course, we will not do that. We follow this law, this word, this book, not what this country says is law. We don't do that. As a result of that also, probably there will be something that I've heard over the years, that there will be a loss of our tax exempt status. You might say, what's the big deal about that? Well, I'll tell you what the big deal about that is in terms of where we function now. It's not just for our purchases. Right now we have a form when you buy something and they'll say tax exempt status and they don't charge you tax for it. We also foresee a time when, because of our stance as a church, that we will also lose our tax exempt status in terms of our facilities, property tax. And I don't really know, I don't know very many churches who can afford financially the kind of tax burden that would be placed on us once. When that happens, I don't know how many churches can do that. As a result of that, we foresee, and I don't want to sound scary to you. In fact, really, part of me, even though I was green the last 2 days, there's a part of me, even as soon as I found out Friday, there's a part of me that got really excited about it, because one of the things that I know has been a problem for us, for the church, you've heard me say this. In this church, in the years that I've been here, I have heard, not a lot, just a handful, I have been given more grief, not because of the biblical teachings that we do, but because I do not permit, and the elders do not permit, the celebration of this country during the worship of the living God. And listen, the commitment that we have is important. I don't know if you notice even what we're doing. We have the announcement, there is a break of a few seconds, and then we read the scriptures, because this time that we have on Sunday morning, is not about our country. It's not about any country. It is about our God, the only true God, who is the Father of the Lord Jesus Christ, and He is the one we worship. And guys, you can fire me. You can do with me whatever you want, but we will stand on the truth of who Jesus Christ is. I show some people and say, well, you're not just patriotic. Listen, you may have been born American. I chose to be an American. I willfully, decidedly signed the papers and said, I want to be an American because I believe in its ideals. But when those ideals clash with the truth of who Christ is and who I am in Christ, I have no equivocation about where I stand and where we stand as a church. We do not stand with the United States with its shame, its face at the face of God. We will stand with Jesus Christ, whatever that cost is. So, at that time, I don't know if that will happen. I don't know when will that happen. I don't know. These are just some things we've talked about. When that happens, there may come a time where we will not be able to afford to be able to meet in this building or any building because we can't afford the taxes. But I don't want you to lose heart. I want you to take heart. 5-6 years ago, I shared with our elders, with our staff, with the guys I meet with on Mondays, that I can see something in the future. It's not that I was being prophetic. This is just something I've seen in a lot of places where Christianity has been persecuted. Christians have been persecuted. I said, I can see us functioning in a way that we function in house churches. We have pastors
who pastor those churches in those house churches and in those house churches, we will perform the function, the biblical function of worship, of making disciples, of evangelism, of ministry, and all the things that we do. And maybe from time to time, we can get together as the different house churches. And we probably could, I could see where a group of elders or pastors can oversee those pastors. And so there's still be this cohesion and oneness of purpose, and make sure that there's accountability about what it is that we are doing. Because what we want is that everything we do is biblically based, gospel focused, and gospel shaped, and gospel centered. So that's what we want. But I want to let you know that, because we don't know what tomorrow will bring, and with the things that's going on, I've already read a lot of things. By the way, natural consequence, we've known this, it's been predicted by even justices, including the Supreme Court, who said this. The decision came down last Friday. Saturday, there was already a cry from the group, I don't know what they call it, the man-boy lover society or whatever, on pedophiles. And they said it is just as natural, the desire that we have for children, it's just as natural as the same-sex desire. And it probably won't stop there. It probably will not stop there. So, part of that is because of the tax things that may be endangered, there may be a change in the way we do things and the structure of colleges around this church. And it's interesting because over the years, we have been functioning with house churches actually on Sunday nights. And so there's already a foundation that has been laid for that for us. And like I said, there will probably be lawsuits, prosecution, both civil, meaning that there will be financial cost to us, and there might even be criminal prosecution when we violate the law, when we are charged, whatever they can come up with. I want to assure you, this is not a question for us of what it is that we're going to do as a church. This is something that it's not hard, it's not easy. Nothing has changed. The church, for a long time, may have flirted with a lot of different things, but our church, we have not flirted. We've stood on the truth of God's word. We have been, I know, for some people, we're just boring. The Bible, the Bible, the Bible. That's a charge against us, you know. Colleges, Baptist church, all the old things, the Bible, the Bible, the Bible. We have tried to do that. All the teachings that we do in Sunday school, in our home groups, Bible studies that we have, and from the pulpit, we have tried to guard that. We just want to proclaim the truth of who God is. I also want you to know that there will be implications for you as individuals, us as individuals, as individual followers of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's already happening. You will probably be shunned if they know where you stand on this. Is Becky here? Okay, so I can talk about it. Yeah, that's right, they're gone. Becky Lee was at the store the other day. She bakes a lot of cakes. If you've seen her work, it's wonderful. She's a wonderful baker. She's very artistic. Not only does the cake taste good, it looks great. The artistry is just, I mean, I don't know why Food Network is not contacting her. She's better than most people. She was at the store gathering up her supplies, and a man was trying to make conversation with her. What are you doing with all this stuff? And so Becky told him, I'm baking these cakes. And the man said, I'm a caterer. So Becky said, pulls out a card and says, if you ever need cakes, call me. The man looked at her card and he said, will you bake a cake for a gay wedding? And she said, no, sir. I'm a believer in Jesus Christ, and that will violate my conscience. And the man, the smile on his face disappeared, thrust back the card to Becky and says, I don't do business with bigots. Turned around and left her.
standing at the grocery store.
That's probably not, will not be an isolated incident. It'll probably be common. And parents, let me say this. If your children stand on the biblical truth, they will be shunned, made fun of, and ridiculed in school. If it's not already happening. Part of this too, especially those of us who teach and who speak. By the way, this sermon this morning is on a podcast. It's going to be on YouTube. There's a chance that anytime we read this text in the scripture, even if we're just reading it, that we will be considered being hateful and be prosecuted according to the hate laws that we have in this country. Which means not only being prosecuted, but there's a chance of imprisonment for that. And it's not, when you come to that point, it is not uncommon to think, it is not irrational to think the next consequence of that, which is martyrdom for some people. I never foresaw it that it will happen in my lifetime in this country. But we're here. So what are we to do? What are we to do? Here's the good part. Here's the good part. Daniel chapter 6. You don't have to turn there. I'll tell you the story. Daniel chapter 6. Daniel was well known to Darius, or Darius, King Darius. And he was a trusted friend and advisor to the king. Where all these satraps and governors and administrators hated him for that. They were jealous of him. They couldn't find anything wrong with Daniel. So they thought, we will figure out a way to get him. And so they convinced the king. They said, King, write a decree that anyone who prays to any god or any man other than you for the next 30 days shall be put into lion's den. And let your name be affixed to this decree. And whatever it is they say, and the laws of the Medes and the Persians cannot be altered, cannot be changed. And so the king signed the decree, and this is what verse 10 says. Now when Daniel learned that the decree had been published, he went home to his upstairs room where the windows opened toward Jerusalem. Three times a day he got on his knees and prayed, giving thanks to his God, just as he had done before. Nothing changed. For the people of God, for you and me, the Great Commission hasn't changed. All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. That hasn't changed. When Peter and John were ordered to stop preaching in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, you know this text, Acts chapter 4. You remember what they said? Shall we obey man, or shall we obey God? For we cannot help but speak about the things we have seen and heard. While our nation has changed, nothing has changed in terms of who we are as believers in Jesus Christ. Jesus tells us in Matthew 5, so let your light so shine before all men that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father who is in heaven. We want to engage the culture with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, hopefully, not as some of those posts that I've seen on Facebook from some quote-unquote Christians were so vitriolic or so ugly. But hopefully we have the heart of the Lord Jesus Christ as he hung on the cross when he asked for the Father's forgiveness for those who put him on the cross. I hope that we, after speaking the truth to people in love, in firmness, and never equivocating on it, I hope that we would have the same heart that Stephen had when he prayed for the very people who were casting the stones, stones is not a good translation, the rocks to kill him. He prayed for them that God would forgive him. He told us, Jesus told us to expect persecution. John 15:20 says, the servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, Jesus said, they will persecute you. That is a reality of the Christian life. Paul says to Timothy in the second letter, everyone who lives a godly life will be persecuted. And Jesus, again in Matthew 5, says this, blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets, he's saying, you're in good company. You're in good company. One of my prayers during this time, in fact, Friday I was at Sam's when I heard the news. And there was that grief that overcame me, but at the same time there was also this excitement that rose from my heart. Because I thought, now we will know what true evangelism is. It will no longer, hopefully, be a project or an event at the church, but it becomes a lifestyle for us. And maybe I'm praying and I'm hoping, even for you who are gathered here this morning, I'm hoping that we will now see a clear demarcation line between who we are as believers in Jesus Christ and who we are as citizens of this country for so long. And I have said this from this pulpit before. We have blurred the distinction between who we are as Christians and who we are as Americans. And hopefully, well, I think the reason we did that, we were doing that, but because there was one time the culture reflected and shared the same values that we had in the church. But no longer, and hopefully you are seeing that, that they are not one and the same. That our allegiance was first and foremost, as Paul says in Philippians, your citizenship is in heaven. That we understand that we have a king to whom we answer to. That no matter what the laws of the land say, it is to Christ that we answer. It is to him. He's the one who's given us our marching orders. And I want you to take heart. I know it sounds so heavy this morning because it's heavy in my heart, but I want to encourage you. Nothing has changed as far as the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. The gospel will go forth. Jesus said, upon this rock, that I am the Christ, that I am the promised Messiah. He says, I will build my church, and even the gates of hell shall not prevent its onslaught. Nothing in this world will prevent the onslaught of the kingdom of God. So, we stay the course. We continue what we have been doing. We will strengthen the church and individuals and families in the church through systematic Bible exposition. That hasn't changed. We've been doing it for really long before I came here. Two pastors before me, and I don't know about the other pastors, but I know Gene and I know Gordon, and I know what they did, and I simply continued what they were doing, the Bible exposition. We will continue to equip individuals and families to share their faith in Jesus Christ, not just when we have programs to do that at the church, but on a daily basis, everywhere we go, we will continue to teach and strengthen the family so that we can be the lighthouse of the gospels and of the gospel in the neighborhoods, in our neighborhoods. We will continue to reach out to our neighbors, the children, the parents, the families, and the teachers at Crockett Elementary School, the students at ASU, the international students whom the Lord is bringing to our doorsteps from other countries. We will continue to build up the body at College Hills Baptist Church through Sunday school, through Bible Life home groups, precept Bible study, men's and women's small groups, and other Bible study groups. This fall, we are introducing a Bible training center for pastors and church leaders to equip the leadership of our church, to equip anybody who wants to be equipped, so that then we can have a biblical foundation. That is the same thing that I do, and some of us do when I travel to the Philippines, when we travel to Kenya. That is the same thing we're doing, and we will continue to do that. I still meet with some pastors, and some of us are still continuing to do what we've been doing, which is to encourage them in the Word of God. Preach the Word. Don't preach a book. Don't preach your experience. Don't preach a magazine article. Don't preach what has come down that you've seen on the internet. Preach the Word. Read it, explain it, apply it. Read it, explain it, apply it. Read it, explain it, apply it until the last breath that we have. We will continue to do that. We will continue partnering with groups, both here in the U.S. and around the world, to spread the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we will do it with love, with grace, with firmness, and we will show them the beauty of our King. And yes, we will continue to pray. Yes, by all means. It's probably one where we're most needed. We need to continue to pray and pray more fervently. And I still hurt inside because the least attended meeting that we have is the Wednesday night prayer meeting. We will do all kinds of things. We will eat, we will study, we will learn Greek and Hebrew. But somehow we don't want to pray. And I want to encourage you this morning. We need to pray. If you have not sensed the darkness that is engulfing this country, then you're either blind or you don't know what's going on, you don't know the Word of God. And listen, there's only one person we can hang on to, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. Yesterday, as we were meeting, with our elders, and I want to thank Andrew, he said, Book of Esther, and I'm going, where's Andrew going with the Book of Esther? We're talking about Supreme Court ruling. You remember when Esther found out, or Mordecai found out about what was going on, that the edict of the king had been issued to wipe out the Jews, perpetrated by one of the kings, somebody by the king's right-hand man, Haman. And Esther, Queen Esther, didn't want to say anything. And remember what Mordecai said. Mordecai told her, who knows that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this? Listen, beloved, listen, believers in Jesus Christ, my brothers and sisters. Listen, count it as a privilege that God has raised you up for such a time like this. Because He wants His children. He wants men and women who are followers of Jesus Christ, boys and girls, to stand up for the gospel, for who He is. Not to be swayed by the winds of the culture, but in the midst of the gales of this cultural change that has swept the country, that we will stand proclaiming the truth of who Jesus Christ is. And so we pray. We also need to repent. We need to ask the Lord's forgiveness for our sins, our unforgiveness. We cannot say anything to the homosexual community when there's adultery and fornication in our hearts and in our midst. We have to live holy lives. And we cannot be silent, not so much in terms of speaking politically, and I hope you get this. The gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ will never be advanced through the political system. I hope this is getting through us today. While we need to participate in the political process, the only true change can come from the power of the gospel converting men and women to Christ. And so the role that we have is not to convince them. It's not even just simply to put our hope in Mike Huckabee, who is a Southern Baptist preacher, or whoever it is. But for us to understand that our hope is in Christ. That's what we've been looking at in Isaiah. The Northern Kingdom, Syria, were coming against them. Instead of turning to the Lord, they turned to Assyria. God says, Assyria will engulf you. Assyria comes against them later on. Who do they turn? Instead of turning to God, they turn to Egypt. And we look at the Israelites, the people of Judah, and says, what's wrong with you? And the question we must ask ourselves is, what is wrong with us? When we would think we can change this country by the political and through the political system, by electing people. Yes, elect people who reflect our values. But listen, it is only through the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ that this country will be changed. Right now, I want to invite you. Would you just come down here to the front and pray with me? And pray for the church that we will be true to the Lord Jesus Christ individually, as families, and as the church of Jesus Christ. Would you do that? Would you just come here and just pray with me?
Would you pray with me, please? Father, I want to proclaim that in the year that Obamacare was passed, in the year that homosexuality was put into law here in the United States, we see you seated on your throne. Though the nations may rage and roar and shake their fist at you, you are still the sovereign of the universe, and you laugh at the petty efforts. Lord God, you are our confidence. You are the source of our confidence. You are the reason that we can have hope and the reason that we can rejoice. They can take jobs, cars, homes, even our very lives, Father, but But you have promised that we are exchanging that which is going to perish in the hour for an imperishable treasure that you are storing for us in heaven. We have the awesome privilege of living with you forever, beholding your glory, beholding your beauty, living in perfect peace forever and ever. So, Father, my prayer is very simple. This may come more from my heart, Father, than from the church. But give us the grace to be faithful and true to you, to not fail in any one point. That when the time of trial comes, if it comes, Father, that we will be found to be true and faithful servants, and that we will hear that from you when we breathe our last breath. Father, we can just rejoice in the fact that if you did not spare your only Son, if you gave him up and poured out your punishment, your wrath, your anger upon him while we were yet in bitter enemies, anything else we ask of you is trivial, and why wouldn't you give it to us? So we just ask for boldness, Father, to proclaim your name, the courage to do so, the strength to do so, and the wisdom to do it, Father. Teach us as you never have from the Word, and empower us like we've never known before, Father, to be faithful servants to you, and to proclaim the fact that this world is going to perish, and our loved ones could quite possibly perish with it. Give us a heart, Father, that no matter what they do, no matter what they say, we look at them like you look at them with a heart of love, knowing that the time is short and wanting all men to come to the knowledge of the truth in Jesus Christ. Please form us more and more every day in your image and the image of Christ, that we think like you, that we speak like you, that we cry with you and that we laugh with you, that in all things we become more like the God who gave us his Spirit, who gave us a glorious body, and has given us a hope through Jesus Christ of an everlasting life. In this we thank you, Father. We thank you for all of the opportunities and the blessings that you have given us to this day. And we look forward to the blessings, the spiritual blessings that you have in store for us in the future. It's in Jesus Christ's glorious name that we pray.
To him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. You're dismissed.